And whenever you read literature, like in the Hindu, any kind of articles comes. So you must know what is cosmos also. Hello students. Today we are going to have a lecture on science and technology topic, which is space and universe. And if we talk about science and technology, it is a very, very interesting area. Most of the students consider it very complicated because science and technology is very vast and it also entails various concepts. However, if we have some curiosity, if we have some understanding, basic understanding of the science, then definitely we are able to tackle the questions that are asked in the UPSC in a very easy manner. Okay, so if we see the science and technology syllabus, we have general science in the prelims, and in the case of mains, we also have space mentioned in the main syllabus. Okay, now if we look at the questions what have been asked in the UPSC, we can see there is a question asked in 2023, cepheids, nebula, pulsars. These are the various objects of the space that have been asked, that have been mentioned by the UPSC and asked about it, some basic characteristic about them. Okay, I have shown some pictures so that you can correlate the questions with the particular aspects of the question. Okay, and these are very easy things if when you understand them. Then we have another question which has been asked in the UPSC, like about the astronomical distances that are measured in light years, and why it is that? Because speed of light is always the same. So there are very, very foundational concepts, like Earth and Moon. There is a speed of light in real time. This is being shown in this diagram. Another question that was asked was about a trio of spacecraft flying in formation of a equilateral triangle. Okay, so this was about Evolved LISA. Okay, so Evolved LISA, you can see here there is an equilateral triangle between three different spacecraft and creating a kind of trio between the three. Okay, among the three. Now another question that was asked is the merger of giant black holes, and it enabled the gravitational waves were detected, of course. However, there was a term used in one of the options, was that singularity. So there may be a possibility that a question may be asked in the coming years about singularity. Okay, and here you can see the famous picture of a black hole that was released by NASA. Another question, you can see light is affected by gravity, universe is constantly expanding or not, surrounding space time. All these concepts are basically major cutting edge astronomical concepts. Okay, and here you can see this particular diagram that I have put here. There are two positions of the stars. One is the actual position, and here the light is coming up, and you can see if we take whether the light is traveling in a straight direction or in the straight line, then we will consider this as an apparent position. However, the actual position is this. So this clearly shows that light is bending. Okay, there is a bend in the light. Now if we look at the questions of the mains, they are majorly of the application part. Like there are spacecraft launching from the Vikram Sarabhai Space Center or James Webb Space Telescope of the NASA. These major questions are majorly from the current affairs. So we will be doing those as well. Our own space station, this was asked in 2019 about the our own space station. And Mars Orbiter mission was also asked in 2017. Okay. So now we come to our own topic, which is space and universe. So first of all, we must understand what is space and what it is all about. So space is any area, any kind of three-dimensional area which takes its own space, which takes its own which like written here, any place or area volume which is empty. It is mentioned as empty, but it can have any kind of things that could be placed in it. Scientifically, it is a boundless three-dimensional extension where objects and events occur. So, like in space, we have many objects. There is sun, moon, and various other stellar objects. Okay, so what is happening? They are existing in a space. They're existing in a three-dimensional position in the manner. Okay, so you can see this diagram. There is a three-axis, x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis. Okay, you can see, or you can just in your very conventional way, this is a y-axis, this is an x-axis, and this is a z-axis. Okay, so this clearly shows that there is something which is of a three-dimensional nature. Okay, three-dimensional nature. So this clearly shows that there is some length, there is some width, and there is some height. Okay, like this is a width, this is a height, and this is a length. Okay, or you can say this is the length. Okay, so okay, so very basic understanding of space is very clear from this particular definition. Now we move towards the types of space with respect to Earth, because we are studying science and technology, and here we especially studying space and universe. So we must understand many kinds of spaces that are existing in the universe with respect to Earth. So with respect to Earth, there are three kinds of spaces. First is outer space, which is just near to the Earth, but it is considered as space. Like there is a particular height beyond which we consider it as outer space, which is called Kármán line, which is a 100 kilometer height in the altitude. Okay, be above the mean sea level. Okay, it has no clear boundary, because you know in the Earth there are various fields. If this is Earth, we know that it is a shape of geoid. Okay, so there is a bulge here. Okay, and there is a flatness here, and because of that, what is happening, that there may be a possibility that the particular kind of boundary could be very narrow here and broad here. This could be a possibility. Okay, so that is why it has no clear boundary. Another reason could be that the atmosphere itself may be having variable movements in the air masses. Okay, that could be a possibility. Like the diagram is where does the space begin? It is about the Kármán line, which is a 100 kilometer height, above beyond which there is aurora. What is aurora? We already know there are many solar particles coming up in the Earth atmosphere, so they create some kind of phenomena called aurora. And there is International Space Station at 330 to 400 kilometers. This is another one. So now, second kind of space is deep space, which is very, very important. Deep space is basically about, it is outside the Earth Moon system, but within the solar system. Okay, so beyond, we can say that beyond Moon, but within the solar system. There are 8 planets, we already know. So we can say there are many missions, like Aditya L1 mission, which is sent to near Moon, near the Sun, and MOM, Mars Orbiter mission. Okay, so they are beyond the Moon, that is why they are under the deep space. And sometimes these keywords are very, very important. If the definitions are clear, you are able to interpret the question very well. Next, there is an interstellar space. What do you mean by interstellar? Interstellar means there are the space between stellar bodies, which is the stellar means the related to stars. Okay, and Sun is also a star. So there could be two different stars, and the space between them would be called the interstellar space. Okay, like this diagram, you can see there is Sun, we have, and all the planets, and then there is an interstellar space which is coming, where we can find Voyager 1, which is a NASA space probe which has been sent, and it has crossed this particular heliopause, which is beyond the basically the solar system. So the boundary of the solar system. So here Voyager 1 has crossed this part, and there is some oot cloud and all these areas. Okay, so beyond this part and from another star, which is Alpha Centauri. Alpha Centauri is another star which is the nearest star to the Earth and even the solar system. So between this Sun and Alpha Centauri, this is an interstellar space, which is very clear. Oh, now you can see influence of any Sun-like star which is beyond the gravitational pull, of course, because there is no gravitational pull applying from Sun to the because its own what we say, the gravitational pull only applies till the solar system, the planets within the solar system, and beyond that there is no effect of the gravitational pull of the Sun beyond that. Okay, and what are the all the things that we find in this stellar space, interstellar space? Charged particles, dark matter, cosmic microwave background radiation. Okay, and all these things we find in this part. Now we move towards, there is some particular terminology that we need to first understand before moving forward. Like, there is space, universe and cosmos. These three things have to be differentiated very clearly. Okay, so what is space? Space is, as I have already defined. Okay, so space is the basically endless and open, where anything can happen, any matter can exist. Okay, this is a three-dimensional space. Okay, then there is universe. So what is universe? Universe is basically everything that is existing in the in our knowledge. Okay, whatever we know, it is the totality of all matter in the existence, along with space and time. Okay, along with space and time, matter and laws governing them. Okay, and it is a very small part of the cosmos. Okay, it is a very small part of the cosmos, and it is the macro part of the cosmos. Okay, so universe is basically what exists, what we can detect, what we can understand and perform experiments upon, or we have some evidence about. Okay, that is called universe. Okay, we have some laws about it, we have some particular evidence about it, so then we call it a universe. Okay, and it is a small part of cosmos, because cosmos, again, the word cosmos itself is a all encompassing word now. Okay, and whenever you read literature, like in the Hindu, any kind of articles comes, so you must know what is cosmos also. Okay, so cosmos is what? It is an order or organization. It is an orderly existence. Okay, cosmos is orderly existence, which may be beyond our universe also. Okay, which we may not be knowing. And nowadays you must have heard about multiverses and different concepts that are coming up nowadays through various research. So this is also a very important a part to understand, like whole harmonious and orderly system governed by natural laws. So cosmos is orderly system governed by natural laws, where you can apply some laws and predict the outcomes. Okay, so this is what entire physical universe, present and future universes. So there are past, present and future universes. What are past universes? Of course, there are many universes which may have existed in the past, okay, and which may have vanished now. Okay, like there is, the whole universe is in dynamism. It is constantly changing. Okay, and non-matter and interactive forces are also included in it. Okay, it covers from micro to macro. So what is micro? Micro is the space which is the part of Earth or very small level, and the macro is the universe which we already know, and all encompassing part is called the cosmos. Okay, now we come to the concept of observable universe, which is very very important, because the UPSC is undertaking very very important interest into these areas. So we will take up the observable universe. What is the observable universe? As the word itself says, the observation, we are able to observe it. There is some light, there is some sound, there is some phenomena happening, and we are able to detect through our various devices, probes, satellites, this kind of things. So we are able to understand it. So the observable universe is the ball assuming isotropic expansion. Okay, it is considered as a ball. Okay, a ball which is a spherical ball, of course, and it is in the form of a ball and radius of 46.5 billion light years from the latest studies, it has been said to be 46.5 billion light years of radius, observable universe, and more than 10 to the power 53 kilogram mass is supposed and estimated to be inside it, and it is that part whose light has reached us, whose evidence has reached us. So that is called observable universe. Second is cosmological horizon. So what is horizon? Horizon is just that limit. This limit is the horizon till where we are able to observe the universe. So that is called cosmological horizon, range beyond which light has not reached us yet. So the universe exists beyond as well. So universe exists beyond as well. Okay, so there is part of universe which has not being exposed to us yet. So universe is very, very important to understand. So here I have included a diagram. There is Earth, then there is solar system, which is part of the solar system. Then there is solar interstellar neighborhood in which the solar system exists, where the sun is there and the solar system is there. Then there is Milky Way galaxy. As we know, we are placed somewhere here. And then we have local galactic group, Virgo supercluster, local supercluster, and finally, which is also known as Laniakea. You must have heard about Laniakea, which is a very important keyword, Laniakea supercluster, and finally the observable universe. Whatever light we have Hubble telescope, and the telescope is capturing lights from various vast distances of light years. So this is what observable universe in a symbolic diagram we have shown. Similarly, this is also 13.5 billion years now, and then observable universe is today is this one, and finally 122 billion years light years, which may be the future observable universe. This is what future observable universe. Okay, so maybe there is a possibility that future universes may be bigger, and we have more understanding of the universe, that we are not alone in the universe also. Okay, now we have to understand the physics behind it. Okay, so what are the units used? First is the light year, which is the most common unit. Okay, so light year is the distance traveled by light in 1 year in vacuum, which is a very common definition. Using the formula, we have this particular formula. Like there is a v is equal to c. C is the speed of light, 3 into 10 to the power 5 kilometer per second in 1 year. So in this way, one light year is multiplying this area, this particular. In 1 year, there are how many seconds? 3.15 into 10 to the power 7. No need to mug up, no need to remember these kind of facts, but just understand that light year is about 9.46 into 10 to the power 12 kilometers, a kind of distance which the light travels in 1 year. It just may not be used in any of your papers, but it's just for basic understanding of science. Okay, then another unit that we use is parsec. It is the distance from the sun. Astronomical object has parallax angle of 1 arc second. So this is another unit that is used in astronomical calculations, parsec. Okay, in case of parsec, we have Earth motion around the sun. Okay, this is sun, and there is Earth moving around it. Okay, this is sun, Earth moving around it in a circular fashion. Okay, in a elliptical manner. Then we have the nearest star. Okay, and some distant stars as well. Okay, so apparent parallax motion of near star will be created through the parallax angle of 1 arc second. So the distance from near star to the earth through the sun will be the 1 parsec. Okay, and there will be some difference. So this particular diagram clarifies more. Like there is a sun, okay, and there is Earth. Okay, so Earth is constantly moving. Okay, so to understand this concept, we have to understand that everything is dynamic. Okay, everything is what? Dynamic. We are constantly moving, the sun is moving. You must have heard that sun is also not constant. Okay, our galaxy is also not constant. Our galaxy is moving towards our nearby Andromeda galaxy, and they may collide in the future. Okay, so this is what, everything is dynamic and happening in this manner. So there are different positioning. The problem comes when we have to measure a position, we have to locate a particular object in the sky. So what is happening is that there is a creation of different locations of the particular object. Like in case here, Earth position, we have this particular a constellation, and in this constellation this particular object we are trying to locate. So when Earth is here, we find it here. When Earth is on the other side of the Sun, we find it on the other side. So there is some difference which is created, which is a parallax angle created. Okay, parallax angle means there are two positions which are in parallel to each other in a opposite manner, and that creates a difference in the location of the position. So there is one location here, another location here, which is creating an angle of 1 arc second. Okay, so here I have also mentioned annual parallax. What is annual parallax? Annual means about the year. There is in case of Earth, Earth is revolving around the Sun, and one revolution is considered as 1 year. So we have from this part to this part, we consider as a one annual parallax, and observing the position of a star at different times of the year, Earth moves its orbit, its value is 3.26 light years. So it is not a very complicated thing. It is very, very easy, and even you may not need to remember it at all. No need to take stress about it. Just take science as in a curiosity manner. Take a curious interest in it, and you will be well ahead of other aspirants to crack the exam. So another unit is the astronomical unit, which is AU, and it is the distance between the Earth and the Sun, which is a very constant distance, about 150 million kilometers. Okay, and it is measured for the solar system, and in light years it is 63241 AU in light years. Okay, so for one light year. Now we have to understand that there are some broader composition of the universe. Okay, what kind of composition we have, what the universe is made up of. Okay, so scientists have been finding out, like, there is dark energy, dark matter, and ordinary matter. There are three things that have been conclusively established through recent research. Okay, and the questions are also coming up in various examinations. Okay, in the UPSC as well. Dark energy, it is about 68%. It is a hypothetical energy, okay, which is causing the expansion of the universe. It is causing the expansion of the universe, okay, at this rate of 70 kilometers per second per megaparsec. Okay, this is the speed of the expansion, which is known as Hubble constant, despite the presence of gravity. Okay, so what is happening? If to understand dark energy, we have to understand what is energy. Okay, and when we take the basic physics class, we will be able to understand more. But here, for your reference, energy is anything, a kind of force which is moving things or making things move. Okay, so this is also energy. Okay, however, there is gravity also. There is gravity of various objects. Whenever there is any matter, there is some gravity around it. Okay, so it is, however, the gravity is also working in at the same time, slowing down the expansion, cooling the universe, and reducing the cosmic microwave background radiations. Okay, so we will talk about it later more. Then we have dark matter. Okay, dark matter, it is about 27%. Okay, now what is dark matter? Then, as the name suggests, dark energy, dark matter. Dark means which is unknown, which is unrevealed. It is hidden somewhere. Okay, so dark matter is also kind of matter, but it is of non-baryonic type. Non-baryonic type means it may not be a kind of baryon. Okay, baryon means a kind of object which is of baryonic type, which is a measurable type. Okay, it may not be measured. That is why it is known as dark matter. Okay, it is non-interactive, with electromagnetic radiations also. Okay, it is does not interact with these, but it is in attractive in nature and having gravitational pull in it. Okay, so this is known as dark matter. So however, you must understand all these concepts are in the developing stage. There are constantly research happening. So these are the basic things that are still still to be clarified. A lot of things need to be researched again. And now finally the ordinary matter, which is only about 5%, very few, very little part, okay, which interacts with the electromagnetic part. As we know, this pen, this is a ordinary matter, okay, made up of the earth materials, okay, and it means that it absorbs, reflects, emits light, okay. Make it easy that half of it is baryonic matter and rest is missing. So again, we have in the ordinary matter, there is some missing matter as well. So this is again being discovered by scientists, that there is some matter which is ordinary matter, but still it is missing. Okay, so what is the missing baryon problem? Okay, this is a missing baryon problem. It is observed discrepancy between the amount of baryonic matter detected from shortly after the Big Bang and from more recent epochs. So whenever the scientists try to gauge and estimate the amount of matter that was exploded and produced in the particular Big Bang, but they are unable to find that some amount of matter out of that particular produced matter, okay, that matter produced or estimated matter. So there is some half of it is a missing baryon which is still under research. Okay, here there is some basic diagram that I have created a table in this image picture. Okay, single largest constituent of the universe, drive universe apart, no interaction with normal matter, and can be thought of fifth fundamental force. So this could be a UPSC question. What has been considered as fifth fundamental force is the dark energy. And in case of dark matter, it is second largest constituent, drive universe together. It is attractive force. It has a gravitational pull in it and interacts with normal matter, okay, by gravity, and finally is not antimatter or black hole. So dark matter is not black hole. This is another, this could be made directly as a statement in one of the options. So dark matter is not antimatter or black hole, okay. Antimatter is basically opposite of the matter, okay. So we will study in detail in physics part. And in the black, or it is neither, it is a black hole which we cannot see, but it is a very dense. What is black hole? It is a very dense dense high gravity, high density collapsed star is called black hole, and dark matter is not black hole, unfortunately, so that we can explain it very easily, okay. So it is different from black holes as well. So this is very important. Now we move to next slide. Here I have explained some brief about origin and expansion of the universe, where the main theory comes, which is the Big Bang theory. Okay, Big Bang theory, we already know, we have studied a lot about it. There was some singularity, there was some atom which was the singular most highly dense hot atom, and which burst, which exploded, and lot of matter and energy was released, and which led to expansion of the universe and creation of space-time and various other physical phenomena that we see. Physical phenomena, physical laws of gravity and motion and everything that is connected to it. Okay, so here what is said, it was given by George Lemaître in 1927. And 13.7 billion years ago, there was an infinitely hot, dense, single point, small volume object called primeval atom or point of singularity, okay, which exploded into matter and energy, creating space-time, so, and causing inflation of the universe. So there was no space-time. And we will also study space-time, what is space-time, in a specific slide. But from here, we can say space-time is just the creation of time, the movement, and how the things are moving up. Okay, so we will study it more. Then the cosmological model, this particular cosmological model called the Big Bang theory, was based on expanding universe hypothesis of Edwin Hubble, who was a scientist in 1920 based on redshift phenomena of long waves. Redshift phenomena is what? Is related to Doppler effect. We will study it in the next slide. Okay. And then we have cosmic microwave background radiation. We will study this as well. This is I am giving you some brief that it is just a background radiation. It was the first, we can say, the first radiation that was emitted after the Big Bang. Okay, so earliest time visible with light. Okay, this was the thing, and background radiations created. Okay, and then we have discovery of abundance of elements. There are many elements we already know. We have the Mendeleev table. So all these elements have been created. I have also shown this particular timeline, how it happened in inflation. There was quark formation, first particle, neutrinos, a proton, dark matter formation, first nuclei, then come helium and hydrogen formation, first light, first atoms formation, then there is dark ages, clamps of matter formation, then there is gravity, and there is anti-gravity. So all these things have been created, and we will be studying it in the coming classes and slides. Now, singularity, the concept you have seen in the previous slide was singularity. So we must know singularity, as it was also mentioned in the UPSC options. So singularity, there are two kinds of singularities. First is the initial singularity that we already talked about, the Big Bang. Okay, so in that we have low entropy explosion. What is low entropy? Low entropy means the particular, there is a less variation in a particular value. Variation in value is called entropy, and if it is low, then it is very low entropy, means there is less variation, mostly constant, nearby constant. Now, and what is happening in space-time and matter immediately following the initial singularity? So after singularity, it is created the Planck's epoch. Okay, it is the earliest period of time in the history of our universe. Okay, then although there is no direct evidence for a singularity in finite density, the cosmic microwave radiation evidence is that the universe expanded from very hot dense atom or point or state. Okay, so this is also a very important thing to understand, that what kind of evidence we are trying to provide for proving that there was singularity. Okay, so it says that there is no direct evidence. However, the cosmic microwave background radiation is the evidence that it is expanding constantly. So it must have started from a particular single point. Okay, this is another one. Then Planck's epoch, the keyword here is Planck epoch. So Planck epoch is basically, it is a prior to 10 to the raised to power minus 43 seconds. See, look at the length, the so small length of time, which is regarding the prior to the 10 raised to the power minus 43 seconds. Okay, so before this time, there was a Big Bang, and after the Big Bang, this particular time period was passed. And before this time, when these four basic forces of nature have been created, like the gravity, there is a nuclear strong forces, nuclear weak forces, and electromagnetic forces, all combined into one, and that leads to creating a super force at the time of Big Bang. Okay, and the second type of singularity is the gravitational singularity, which we always talk about in the black holes. So in the black holes, this diagram is created. There is a three-dimensional diagram. Okay, so in that, we know that around the black hole, at the center of black hole, there is the highest gravity point. And at this point, there is a very high dense approaching the infinity. Okay, so it's a condition in gravity predicted to be intense. Space-time itself would break down at this point. Okay, so this term is to describe the center of black hole approaching infinity. Okay, so this is the diagram for this particular, our Big Bang inflation and the singularity of the beginning point. Now, cosmic microwave background radiation, it is another concept that you must understand in detail, a brief, because this could be an probable question in the prelims. Cosmic microwave background is basically the earliest radiation after the Big Bang. Okay, because we are able to perceive it. See this diagram. This clearly shows there was a presence of 13.7 billion years, and then there was a radiation CMB list happening, cosmic microwave background radiation surface of the last scatter. Okay, and what we can see as a person, we can only see the surface of the cloud where light was last seen. You must have seen that when sky is filled with clouds and there is sun in the background, there is a radiation scattering. There is a radiation scattering, sunlight scattering through behind it. So that is what is the analogy that we derive and provide for understanding the particular CMB radiations. Okay, and they can be detected in every direction. So in any direction, it was an isotropic movement in equally in all directions. It was generated when our universe was only 380,000 years ago. So it was very 380,000 is a very, very small time duration in after the creation of the universe. So it was a million times smaller than today and has a temperature of about 9700 degrees Celsius, which is a very, very high temperature, but not that much of high temperature if we compare it to the core of the sun. Okay, but at that time everything was in the state of plasma. So we already know about plasma. Plasma is what? It is the fourth state of matter where charged ions and negative and positive ion particles exist. So at that time what happened? There was only charged particles at this temperature. Then there, it is also known as cooled remnant of the first light, increasingly red shifted nowadays. So of the universe, it is energy is being constantly diluted. It will disappear in few trillion years, not million years, not billion years, oh, 3 trillion years, because it was a result of Big Bang. It was so high, it was so much that it will not go for another trillion years, as the studies and the calculation estimations of the scientists predict for us. And finally, the short wavelengths of the gamma radiations emitted in the initial explosion are believed to have stretched. So this is very important to understand that there was some radiation which was of very high frequency. Then it led to towards the lower frequency. And what was the reason? Because expansion of space into longer wavelength microwaves happened in the later phases. In the beginning it was very high frequency, and later it was due to gravity, due to effect of various other forces, it led to into a lower frequency domain. Okay, so now if we if the question comes like the cosmic microwave background, so it is name is microwave but is still in the long wave spectrum. Okay, we will also look towards the spectrum as well. Now we have to understand the Doppler effect. Doppler effect is basically, as we have already talked about, that the CMB radiations are increasingly redshifted. So what do you mean by redshift? Okay, so redshift is all about what? It is about the application of Doppler effect. Here we apply the principles of Doppler effect, where redshift and blue shift, there are two phenomena. Okay, so in the case of frequency of sound, light and other waves, source and observer move towards each other. Wave emitted by a source traveling towards an observer get compressed. So this is a very important to understand how to this Doppler, what it is trying to say. See, very basic example you can take of a train. Okay, I can take an example of a train. See, if this is a train, okay, and you are an observer. You are an observer. So if the train is coming towards you, what is happening? The sound is constantly increasing and screeching in your ears. Okay, the frequency increases, high frequency. Okay, however, if the train goes away from you, what happens? The frequency goes toward the low frequency domain. It is lower, the pitch is getting lowered as the distance increases. Okay, so this is what is being reflected in the Doppler effect. The same thing we apply when we try to measure the distances of the particular objects in the space. Okay, here we can see moving bell. This diagram also shows that, okay, the wavelength is decreasing. In this case, wavelength is increasing. So sound waves are if they are coming on, if the observer is moving on that side, there is a lower frequency here, the higher frequency here, I mean to say. On the other hand, if things are getting away, this is of a lower frequency. Okay, so you can see lower pitch is happening on this side, higher pitch happening on this side. As we know, if there could be a train or any kind of object which is a source of sound, okay, so this is a possibility of higher pitch approaching it and moving away from it, there is a low pitch. And long wavelength means low frequency, the same thing is lower pitch, so these things are also connected. On the other hand, short wavelength is about higher wave frequency and higher pitch. As we already know, this is, if we look at the frequency, simple sine wave, this is a simple sine wave. What is happening between two crests? There is a distance which is known as lambda. Lambda is what? Wavelength. So if there is a wavelength, we can take the center point. This is the wavelength. So higher the wavelength, we know that there is a higher, there is a lower frequency. And if there is a lower wavelength, there is higher frequency. Okay, and wavelength, if the wavelength increases, what happen? There is a low frequency there. Okay, so this is to understand, like short wavelength, there is high frequency, long wavelength, low frequency. So very, very basic concepts of physics we will also discuss in basic classes as well. Okay, and you can see this particular spectrum, we all study it in our class, in our ninth class, like gamma rays, GAX UV MER, you must have heard GAX UV MER. Okay, this is a acronym that we use for it. Okay, so gamma rays, X-rays, UV rays, then there is radio waves and microwaves, radio waves. Okay, there is some microwave here. Okay, microwave here, GAX UV MER. And so this is the thing about Doppler effect. So Christian Doppler was there in 1852. He explained this concept. Redshift is shift from shorter wavelength towards longer wavelengths from high wave. Redshift basically means is this thing, moving away. So redshift is about away. Okay, so this is the thing. Then we have higher wave to lower frequency and reciprocally to the blue shift. As in this diagram you can see, there is low frequency, low pitch. Okay, lower frequency, low pitch. Low pitch is what? There is a bass in it. Okay, bass. Or you can just simply compare it with male and female voices. So female voices are high frequency. Very simple to understand, female voices. Okay, female sound, female speech is of high frequency, higher pitch, higher frequency. On the case male, it is a lower frequency, bass, or you can call it treble. You must have seen in the speakers. Then there is observer, source and observer. Okay, these are the things. I think it is clear. Now, space versus time versus space time. This is a concept very, very important to differentiate between these things, because the space-time was a particularly a concept which was the particular keyword space-time was used in that definition in the earlier slide. So you must know space is what? Already told, the three-dimensional space we talk about in the XYZ. There is time, which is non-relativist classical mechanics of Newtonian. Newtonian mechanics is talking about the time. Okay, here universal quantity of measurement is there, separate from space, and is by all observers, it is agreed by all observers, assuming that time has a constant rate of passage independent of the observer state of motion. Okay, so time is basically what? It is basically things are happening from one duration, one point of time to other point of time. The particular is taken as a duration. It is a universal quantity of measurement. We can say it is uniform throughout and agreed by all observers. Okay, so that is in a Newtonian way. We will discuss it more. Okay, then finally we have space-time. Space-time is basically a mathematical model. It is a model where that fuses three dimensions of space and one dimension of time as well. So it is a space-time is basically what? Three dimensions of space, of course, x, y, z, and there is a time as well, which is a another dimension of another dimension, which is considered a four-dimensional continuum, is created in space-time. As we have already told in the Big Bang, what happened in the Big Bang? After the expansion, there is inflation and the creation of space-time, which is a four-dimensional existence of things. Okay. And it is known as event. Okay. So in the Einstein's general theory of relativity, space-time is no longer a static background, but actively interacts with the physical systems. Okay. Space-time curves in the presence of matter and propagates waves, bends lights, and exhibits a host of other phenomena. So space-time is what? Space-time is basically a no longer a static, okay, background. It is actively interacts with the physical systems. So to understand space-time, you must understand how the distance is measured, how the things are interacting with each other. Okay, so like in this diagram, we have sun, actual position of star, perceived position of star from the earth. So how we see whatever is visible on our telescopes may not be the real picture. Okay, light is bending towards it. Okay, grid representing the space-time. So space-time is basically a kind of grid. It is a fabric of space. But it is bent by various forces like the sun's gravitational force around it. Okay, so that is happening, and the light itself is basically moving, not in a straight line. So if you see, if light is not moving in a straight line, though its speed is constant, all of our understanding, you know, changes, because the basic phenomena is distance is equal to speed, speed is equal to distance upon time. But if distance is not straight line, it is a bent line, everything changes. So that is what is about Einstein's general relativity. Okay, and these are some general diagrams for that. So thank you very much. I think you will be having, after this lecture, a proper understanding and a perspective of space and universe, of what all things lie in it, and you will definitely be able to have a curious interest in science and technology. And I think I would be available for any queries. Whatever questions you have, you can send me, and I will be available at Plutus IS. And thank you very much. Keep studying. All the best.